Yeah, so thanks everyone for coming, especially since this is the last slot and there's a closing game after this one. I don't think you need to run out after my talk. There's 15 minutes or so to get over there. And yeah, so yeah, let's get started. I'm Jan Lübbe, I'm from Pangotronics. I started there doing kernel development work and now do talking with customers, finding out what they want to do, and looking at other technologies that are coming up and deciding how they fit into the embedded context. So you probably all basically know that as the Linux storage stack in a very simplified way. So on one hand, we have block devices. That is the normal hard disk drives, SSDs, SD cards, and so on, where you have normal file systems on top. And in some cases, you can have the device mapper layer in between, which can do interesting things with the data in between the file system and the block device. And on the other hand, you have the MTD layer, which is used mostly on embedded devices to store data on storage devices that are not as simple as here, you write this block to this address, so where you need to do more stuff. So, for example, like NAND flashes. And to make that usable for file systems, for data storage, there's the UBI, unsorted block images layer in the Linux kernel, which is then used by file systems like UBIFS. So, and on top of this stack, we can introduce encryption, authentication, and both at the same time at various levels. And we could also do that in our own applications, but for this talk, I'm only looking at layers or infrastructure which is already in the Linux kernel so that the authentication and encryption is transparent to the application. So that's what I think is most useful for general embedded devices. And interestingly, in any given project, only usually one or two of those is actually a good choice. And if you choose the other one, you're choosing a lot of pain. Probably not initially, but maybe later when you do things that don't really fit to what that layer is providing you. So there was the word crypto three times on the last slide. So we need a bit of cryptography knowledge, not much, so I'm going to give a quick refresher. Most of you probably know at least some of those. So we're going to talk about hash functions. This is a mathematical algorithm which takes a chunk of data and produces a deterministic fixed size result, independent of how large the input data is. And the interesting thing at that level is that you can't go back from the output to the input, and that you cannot generate another block easily. It is not feasible to generate a different block of input which produces the same output. That is what we usually use in the form of the SHA algorithms, SHA-1 or 256, and so on. So building on top of a hash function, you can have the hash-based message authentication codes, which is basically a method of using a hash together with a secret to authenticate data. The way that this works is that you take the hash, put the key in first, then your data, and hash the result so that you can see if the person that generated this HMAC is also in possession of this secret, which is usually yourself at an earlier point in time. So the next step relates to public key cryptography. There is the concept of a signature, which is used for data authentication. So you have a private key on one hand, which you use to produce a signature for some data, and someone else can use the corresponding public key to make sure that this data was actually signed by the holder of the private key. So this way we can separate authentication from the between multiple people or systems. Coming to encryption, there are, for this talk, basically two relevant differences. There's unauthenticated encryption and authenticated encryption. So for the unauthenticated encryption, that is what we usually use on disk encryption and so on. I take a block of data, I have a key, encrypt this block of data, store it on a device, but any attacker cannot decrypt this, but he can modify it. And I can still take this modified encrypted block, decrypt it, and I will get something out. And that may look like random noise, it may look like somewhat like my initial data, but there's nothing telling me that this was modified. And this is exactly what I get with authenticated encryption. So at the decryption step, the algorithm tells me if this was the original data or if it has been modified. So I'm now going through the different implementations I had on the storage stack for authentication, encryption, and the few cases where we can do both at the same time. And I will go through them beginning from the block device, going up through the layers, ending on top of the file systems. And afterwards, I'm going to talk a bit about some general considerations which come up when implementing such mechanisms. So, and if at any point I'm not explaining something in enough detail, please wave at me or shout, and I'll try to explain it in more detail. So beginning, we start with DMVerity. That is element in the device mapper layer, which can be used to authenticate data. So I take my file system, put it into a DMVerity container, basically, and store that on my block device. And in addition to the original file system data, I have a tree of hashes. So basically, I have my data pages from the file system. I take a few of those, hash each block individually, put all those hashes in a new block, do that for some other nodes, and now I have a new layer which are blocks full of hashes, and hash those again up the tree until I end up with only one hash. So this allows me to make sure that each individual block that I read from the file system, I can look at the, in the hash tree, go up the layers, and find out if that is actually intended to be at that location in this file system. That works only if I know the original root hash. So this has to be provided out of band. Originally, that was done by the bootloader in the kernel command line, or it was compiled into the kernel. So the kernel basically knows which root file system it expects. And no single block in this image can be changed. But I'm sure that the original data is there when I read it. And I don't need to go through all the blocks initially to check them. I can just do that incrementally when I read each block. And very recently, the mainline kernel has gained support to have a signature in this root block. So I can do signature checking of the root file system by just having a public key in my kernel image, and I can then easily update the root file system and just check the new signature and boot that. So that's very new. The tools to create that and configure it is in Verity Setup. That comes from the Lux2 package, so it's probably installed on most of your laptops, together with Crypt Setup and some other tools. So usually you combine it with something like X4, SquashFS, or the EROFS for it's a newer read-only file system. And in that way, it has been used in the past and currently as well for Chrome OS and Android. So they have fixed root partitions that they check at each access. So At the same layer in the device mapper layer, there is the DM integrity module. So the DM Verity only supports read-only file systems. So if I want to have a file system which authenticates my data but is also writable, I need to do something more complex. So I have, for each block of data, I have some additional smaller space where I can store authentication data. And this was not invented by the Linux device mapper people, but by the storage industry. They have something called T10, or device integrity format, which is initially was done for SCSI devices and SAS disks, where they have, for each data sector, some additional space to store integrity data. And basically, this API is emulated by the DM integrity module. But to do that, it needs additional space. So after several blocks, we get one block of integrity data because the integrity data is smaller. And this single block combines integrity data for the preceding data blocks. That leads to a problem when writing to this. What happens if I write data and then my system crashes and I haven't updated the integrity data? So on the next boot, there's a mismatch and I can't read my data, or at least get an authentication error. So what DM integrity does is it has journaling for the data and for the integrity metadata. So each write is all first written into journal, and after it's committed into the journal, it's written in the normal data area. So that costs some performance, because basically every data element is written twice. So yeah, we lose some performance for that. And on its own, it can use simple checksums to detect data corruption, but not intentional attacks. And that's configured by, via integrity setup. So then there's DMcrypt. That is probably the best known of the methods I'm going to talk about. It's a module to do sector-based encryption. So I take a sector of data, encrypt it, and write it into my block device. That's pretty simple at that level. It supports many different algorithms, can get its encryption keys in several different ways, and it's usually configured, at least on desktop systems, using crypt setup. The crypt setup tool has gained recently a new feature for re-encryption. So you can change the underlying encryption key on the fly. For example, if you remove someone from the access list of your server, you can re-encrypt all data so that person does not have access to any further data that you write. And again, it does not authenticate. And that is because to authenticate, we would need some additional space to store this authentication data. That is an underlying constant of encryption and authentication. The normal length for preserving encryption can only be unauthenticated. So irrelevant which algorithm I use, as long as I don't have additional space, I can't authenticate. So that's what DMcrypt does. Is a good choice for laptops. If I don't have additional space, or if I need the performance, at least I have encryption, and it's hard for an attacker to modify something specific, but I'm not really protected against that. So, and that's something gained in the recent years, that I can combine DM integrity and layer DMcrypt on top. And at that point, DMcrypt has some space to store this authentication data. So when I encrypt in sector, I get additional authentication data, and that is stored in this metadata area provided by DM integrity. So at that point, I can, if I read back a sector from the storage device, run the authenticated encryption and can detect intentional modifications. There's one downside to this, or limitation, is that because it's sector-based, I cannot detect if this is the correct version of this sector that I'm reading. So an attacker could take an old sector from an old copy, put that onto my device, and I would not notice that this has been modified. But depending on which attackers you're expecting, that might be accepted. And it's definitely more secure than just using dmcrypt without authentication. And so there are, again, several algorithms supported by dmcrypt with authentication. They're called AEAD algorithms, so it's authenticated encryption with associated data. But we don't have any associated data, it's just authenticated encryption in our case. So the recommended algorithm is AGIS 128 random, so it uses a random initialization vector for each sector. And that's also a security improvement about what dmcrypt can do without authentication. So moving up a layer, in file systems, we now have, since the very last mainline kernels, something called fsverity, which is basically the same idea we had with dmverity, but applied to files. So the main use case for that is authenticating large files on a writable file system. So the main use case where this was invented for is Android packages on mobile phones. So you download a large APG to your X4 file system or some other writable file system. And the Android runtime wants to make sure that every time it accesses this APK, that it's still unmodified compared to what it's downloaded from the store. So you basically have a file system call, which you can run on a single file, and the file system will generate this hash tree for you, report the root hash back, and then you can check that this root hash is the one you expected. And after this point, the file system is completely immutable. So after the next reboot, anytime you want to verify this file, you can ask a file system for the root hash and compare it to your own database, which is stored somewhere else. And then on each access to this file, the hash tree is used to authenticate the data that has been read. So you get authenticated read-only files on a writable file system. So yeah, Android is basically the main user for this. And there are some ideas to integrate this with IMA, which I'm going to talk about later. So, and basically the same idea with dmverity and fsverity is with dmcrypt and fscrypt. So we have block-based encryption of files at the file system level that allows you to have different keys in a single file system, which is again interesting for Android or any other multi-user system. So each user can have its own keys on the shared file system, so you can reuse the free space dynamically between the different users. And one additional benefit is that you can mount the file systems without having the key, and you can also remove complete directory trees without having this key. So for example, if you have an Android phone and added an additional user and later want to delete this user, you don't need to have the corresponding encryption key. You can just delete that subdirectory completely and the file system doesn't care. So from the security side, it's basically the same as dmcrypt, but has more complex key management because you need to manage keys for each user. So it's only really useful if you have a system where you want to have users with their own passwords or their own encryption keys and need to share space between them. And since last year, there's basically the single case where a file system does authentication of the complete data in the Linux kernel with UBIFS. That this works with UBIFS is a lucky coincidence, maybe, because UBIFS is a file system specifically designed for flash use cases. And with this constraint, the file system is built in a way that it never overwrites data, which is a problem we've seen with DM integrity. You cannot simply update things in place and keep the hash trees in sync. So by just never overwriting data and storing all the file system data and metadata in a tree, which is basically written linearly over the flash and then regularly garbage collected, you can just add hashes to each of these tree nodes, which then authenticates the parts that are below those tree nodes. So with one single key, you can have authentication of the whole file system and file system metadata, but only for UBIFS. So in one case, the root hash is authenticated via HMAC, so it's a fixed secret, or you can have a signature in the root hash, in the root node, similar to what has been done for DM Verity for initial flashing in the factory. So every system gets its gets the same image, signed with a public key, and on the first boot, the system uses its own key to update that to a HMAC. And then the system file system is writable. So it's the best choice for NAND and other raw MTD devices, probably because it's the only choice. But then at least you get authentication, and you can use FSCrypt again to encrypt specific parts of that file system. So on NAND flash, you can't use device mapper, so there's no decrypt and so on. So there's also EcryptFS, probably long-time Ubuntu users know about that. It's a stacked file system, so you mount it on top of a different file system, and it encrypts all files in this upper file system. That has been used for home directory encryption per user by Ubuntu since over 10 years ago, but it's now deprecated, and they use DMCrypt as well as most other distributions. And the Ubuntu employees that have previously maintained that now do other things, so the maintenance is a bit unclear. The kernel part is still maintained, but the user space tools didn't get releases for some time now, and so it's probably not a good idea to use that for new systems. So, and it has no authentication. There were some patches for authenticated encryption posted several years ago, but they were never merged. And I consider it superseded by FSCrypt. Then there's IMA EVM, which is a bit on a tangent. It's layout on top of a file system, but it's not a file system by itself. It stores its own metadata in extended attributes in a file system, and it's mainly initially developed for use with TPMs and trusted boot or verified boot and remote attestation, so that a remote system can prove that your computer or your laptop or your desktop in the company is running the approved software image. And it does that by having hashes of each file in extended attributes and sending those to the TPM so the TPM can basically log which files have been accessed. And if only authentic whitelisted files have been accessed, then the system is trusted and secure. So that alone cannot be used by the system itself to protect it against any attackers that wants to modify files, because only the remote system can then detect that it's not in a secure state anymore. So the idea was to introduce this EVM, extended validation module, on top of that, which basically uses HMAX again to authenticate each individual file. But then you have, at least currently, because some parts of the initial design have not been implemented, there are attacks possible, like copying the shell over the init binary. And then you reboot the system. EMA EVM detects that's an authentic file, but it cannot know that it's in the wrong location, so we get a root shell. So it's interesting for remote authentication, but more or less useless currently for protecting the system itself against modification. So there's a talk on Monday by Luke Hinz about the Keyline project. That's yeah, infrastructure for doing this remote authentication. So if you're interested in that, go to his talk and watch the recording. So we've now gone through several implementations, but there are some things that apply basically to all of them. Initially, where do we store the key to authenticate or decrypt our file system? So we now have a mechanism to encrypt data, but we still need to have some key that is not readable by the attacker. So on a desktop or laptop system, the way this is usually done is the user has to enter a password. The key is derived from that. And so an attacker that simply steals the laptop does not have the password, so does not have the key. For embedded systems, that is not really useful because there's usually no user who wants to enter the password to talk to his fridge or whatever. So many of those embedded SOCs have some mechanism to store a secret key inside the SOC itself that can be used to encrypt such secrets. It's usually called wrapping keys. And that can be used together with a verified boot or secure boot to make sure that only the authentic bootloader or kernel can access this key and decrypt the rest of the data. But there are other talks at this conference and previous iterations to look at how this works. And also by Gilad Ben-Yosef, he had a talk earlier today, how that can be done with the mainline kernel today. And other options to store this data are TEES or OPTI, which is an open source trusted execution environment on ARM platforms, which is basically the way that Android does this. So they have a TEE running in a separate processor mode to store such secrets, or you can use a TPM to store that secret. So when we think about these mechanisms, there are some which apply to read-only file systems, which are very low overhead, like DMVerity, but they have the downside of being read-only, so I can't just edit my configuration files in the root file system. But I still have usually some configuration data or application data that needs to be stored somewhere else. So I need to decide how to partition my system in usually read-only root file systems and maybe the application file system and writable data partitions. So I can use the high performance and more simple DMVerity for the root file system and do some things like DM integrity with DMcrypt for authenticated encryption on the data side. So I only have the overhead of the combination and the additional logging for the errors where I actually need it. So in the case where we have authenticated storage, we cannot actually protect against an attacker which gets into our system by some network exploit and then just uses the system as it is to write to that authenticated partition because he has access to all the keys. So if we only had authenticated writable storage, after such an event, I would need to destroy my device and get a new one. So usually it's useful to have some sort of read-only authenticated recovery partition that can be used to erase all the writable parts, restore the factory state, and get back to a working state after an exploit. And for the developers among us, it's also a use case that needs to be thought about in advance, but only heard later, because we will get devices back from the field which have failed in some way that we don't understand. And when we have systems which are locked down with verify boot and have only authenticated storage, we usually can't do the normal debugging approach we are used to. So a possible way to do that is to have a way in the bootloader or early kernel startup that can erase these encryption keys, which are used for our customers' data, so which are intended to protect those data partitions, just erase them and disable verified boot. And then you can just use your normal mechanisms to start another kernel and look at how does the file system layout look, how does the NAND flash work, and so on, to at least get some data back out of those return devices. So coming to the end, some recommendations. So for read-write-block devices, use dmcrypt, as you're used to with laptops, possibly with a DM integrity, if you can take the performance hit and need the additional authentication. Use dmVerity for read-only file systems because it's simple and well-tested. On NAND flashes, you can use UBFS and enable encryption authentication if you need it. And do something like verified boot, key wrapping to store the actual master key, which is the root of the security of the rest of the system. And then use hardware acceleration for doing hashes and encryption on those socks. It's usually well supported. So in summary, avoid the complexity and only select the necessary components depending on what you're actually defending against. Yeah, so that concludes the talk. I'd be happy to take questions. Thank you. Yeah, so I have a microphone here, which I'll pass around the room. Maybe just come forward.
Thank you. You said something about replay attacks, because even though the sector is authenticated when it's encrypted, you could take a previous sector and replace it. Is there any way to work around that?
That's correct. So currently, what is implemented in the Linux kernel, there's no way around that, at least for dmVerity and dmcrypt. So UBFS authentication would detect that because that's a continuous tree up to the root hash. So you only have the most recent consistent version. But as it's sector-based, if an attacker has access to the device at two points in time, can make a copy and then return sometime later to restore maybe an old vulnerable kernel, then he can do that. If he figures out where your partitions are, so he still can't read the data, so he needs to have some other way to find out which parts he needs to replace. That is definitely hard, but it's not prevented by the mechanism itself. So this limitation is known to the people implementing this, and they're definitely thinking about ways how to solve that on the sector level, but you can search for the authenticate full disk encryption problem. It's cryptography research, and it's not solved in a general high performance way. Yeah, someone else. Yeah, if no other questions come up, then thanks a lot. And have fun.